Hello there and welcome to my channel. I'm Christian and you are watching A Dev Story. Today I will be explaining design patterns with special emphasis on object orientation. If you don't know too much about object orientation, don't worry, check out my other videos first. And also, if you like to keep up to date with computer science topics, don't forget to click the subscribe button. With that away, let's start. Many of the software development problems that you will encounter during your professional life have already been solved by someone else. Additionally, you probably will work on a team or need to communicate with some technical stakeholders. By using common and proven solutions, you will be able to benefit from faster deliveries, more robust and maintainable software, and better communication with your peers. Design patterns are reusable solutions to problems given a certain context. Notice the three important parts: context, problem, and solution. There is an infinite number of design patterns. Different paradigms, programming languages, and frameworks can have different design patterns for specific scenarios. When thinking about design patterns, it's inevitable to think about the Gang of Four, and specifically the book where they published the object-oriented design patterns in 1994. The Gang of Four split the design patterns into three types: creational, behavioral, and structural. Creational focuses on class instantiation, or in other words, objects creation. Behavioral focuses on the communication between objects, and the structural focuses on how to store the information. In total, they originally introduced 23 patterns. You might have heard of some of them, like singleton or factoring. Now, you might say, hey Christian, but you mentioned that there were initially 23 design patterns and that there's also an infinite number of design patterns. Should I learn them? And how can I learn them? I personally think that the more design patterns that you know, the more tools you have to design good software. So, should you learn them? I'd say yes. Nevertheless, if you don't practice and understand deeply why are they needed, then probably you won't be able to use them effectively. Now, regarding the second question on how to learn them, let's start with when to use them. When you're coding and something is weird, or you are not happy with how hard it is to understand, explain, change, or test something, there might be an underlying issue. Many of these issues can be fixed with use of design patterns. In the context of object orientation, I suggest you to think about the problem into one of the three types that we saw before. Is it a behavioral problem? Is it a creational, a structural? When you have this problem categorized, then you look for the solution. For example, let's say we have this class user. It has first, middle, last, and username, but also age, home address, and phone. Some of these attributes are mandatory and others are optional. So what's the problem here? It seems that it has too many varying attributes and could be constructed differently depending on what you need. As a programmer using this class, it can be hard to know how exactly to create an instance of the user. We can have, for example, multiple constructors with different parameters, or have too many parameters in one constructor, where the programmer using this class will have to pass in the empty values, for example. Another problem is, what happens if you need to add a new attribute, say mail address? Where should you put it? Should you put it in all the constructors? Only in some, in a new one? These are a lot of questions that this class, as it currently stands, brings to us. We can see this is a problem with the creation of the object. So we can focus on checking out the creational design patterns. Reviewing the creational design patterns, we can see that a builder pattern is useful to create complex objects. Let's give it a try. In this case, we end up having the class and a builder class for it. The builder class handles the complexity of the multiple options to initialize the class in a clearer way, allowing programmers using the user class to have more flexibility in the creation of the object, as well as easier maintenance for us when we need to add new attributes, making it clear which are mandatory and which aren't. Here we try the builder pattern, but it's also fine to try out other patterns and see which one works better for you. Alternatively, to design patterns, there are also anti-patterns. An anti-pattern is a common response to a recurring problem that is usually ineffective and many times counterproductive. Sometimes overuse, wrong context, a bad implementation, or even new discoveries can make a design pattern become an anti-pattern that you should avoid. In the previous example, one way we could have solved the multiple parameter options could have been through the telescoping constructor pattern. This implies having multiple constructors with different parameters to build a complex object. This is thought to be an antipattern. If you have just a few overloading constructors with few parameters, then it might be fine. But as you start growing the number of parameters, then it can become harder and harder to maintain. Now let's summarize. First, there are a lot of design patterns and antipatterns. Also, when building applications, if you find problems, try to look for design patterns in that specific context. Third, try to be thoughtful about using design patterns. A bad use of them can also lead to antipatterns. The key here is practice. Once you start practicing this more and more, many of the design patterns will come natural to you. You will see. And that's it for today. If you have any comments or questions, don't hesitate to put them in the comment section below. And if you enjoyed this video, please click like, share it, and very importantly, subscribe. Thank you very much again, and see you next time. Bye.